What's up you guys? Welcome back to my channel and welcome to another video. Today we're gonna be talking about getting started as a bikini competitor. This is such a requested video. Like people ask me about this all the time and I recently put up a post on my Instagram and this was definitely the most common video request. Without further ado, we're gonna split this into four main parts. These are choosing a show, when should you compete or how long should you wait until you compete, prepping for the show, like how long for, how to go about it. Finally, on show day, what to expect, how shows work. Before we start those, I just wanted to quickly run over what it means to compete or what it means to be a bikini competitor. So the aim in a bodybuilding competition is to reduce your body fat while maintaining muscle mass as much as possible. So between categories, the amount of muscle mass they're looking for and the amount of leanness they're looking for changes. On a whole, that's kind of the general idea. Okay, so part one is choosing a show. So when you're considering a show, there are five main things that you should consider. The first one is the show type. There are loads of different shows out there now. There's more popping up all the time. Obviously, there's gonna be like the main federations that are the most kind of well known and have the most competitors and things like that. New ones are coming along and they're growing quickly and so on. So there are a few different kinds of shows and I like to think of them as kind of like old school bodybuilding shows and then kind of new age, like glamorous shows. This isn't like a technical divide in the industry or anything, but it's kind of the way it is in my eyes anyway. So some federations are more about just the physique on stage. There's no like music, there's no like show stuff. Whereas other shows are kind of all about the glamour, all about the kind of model, the kind of fitness model type. If you think you like the sound of the kind of glamour side of it more, then definitely look into those shows and find ones that represent that for you. This is definitely what got me into competing because I just thought it was incredible when I discovered the WBFF and I just saw how they could combine like fitness and beauty so well. Yeah, that's just what like caught my eye and made me like really, really want to do this. Number two is category. So once you've decided on a show, you then need to decide which category you're going to enter. There tends to be loads of different categories depending on what show you've picked. And your best option to find which category you suit the best is to find people that compete in those categories. So find them and like go on their Instagram pages and find pictures of them in their off season and see which kind of body type you match up to the most, which one your proportions kind of fit with, and that will give you the best idea of which category you're going to be best suited for. Third is regulations. So you want to have a look and see if this show has any regulations that you don't necessarily like or whatever. So some shows have different regulations for posing. So that would be a big one for me because I think that my posing on stage is one of my kind of favorite parts. So if a show kind of limited what I could do or had like compulsory poses that I didn't like or didn't think suited me, that would definitely sway me away from a certain federation. Some shows also have like bikini regulations and shoe regulations and things like that. So just have a look and make sure that it's something that definitely suits you and that you definitely want to do. Fourth is location. This is kind of obvious. Like you want to pick a show that's easy enough for you to get to, especially if it's your first one. And fifth is cost. Depending on what federation you go for, the entry fees will be different. The cost of bikinis will be different. Even things like stage photos. Check all this out first and make sure it's something that you can definitely afford to do, because you don't want to break your bank doing something, especially if you're kind of just testing the water and seeing if it's something that you do like. Okay, so part two is when should you compete? So technically there is no rule to this, guys. To be honest, it's really kind of category dependent or show dependent. If you're entering a kind of novice bikini category, they don't look for a huge amount of muscle mass. They don't even look for a huge level of leanness either. There's no reason why somebody who hasn't necessarily been going to the gym that long couldn't do a category like this. Once you start looking into kind of fitness categories or figure categories for women, and obviously bodybuilding, which is kind of a huge step up, that's when you need to have well-developed muscle, size, density, well-developed proportions. Remember that muscle takes a long time to develop. I went into my first prep kind of just on a whim, but I was already somebody with a good muscular base. Like I didn't just walk into the gym for a few days and then decide I was gonna do a cut, which I think some people think that because my first like transformation photo, so you couldn't really see the muscle I did have. I used to do a lot of sport as a child. Like I did a lot of like sprinting and gymnastics and stuff like that. So I'd built up a good muscle base before, like long before I even started going to the gym. So that's why I was able to do that. So my best advice if you're unsure about this is to find yourself a coach. I'll bring this up again in the next point, but if you find a coach who knows what they're talking about, who's prep people like you before or even competed in your federation or category before, then they will be the best person to tell you like how long until you can start your prep or how much more muscular development you need for that category and so on. That is my best advice. The last thing to think about before deciding when to compete is, are you ready? Competing is a huge, huge commitment. Like, I can't even tell you how many things I've sacrificed for competition prep and for my career in general. It is crazy, guys. Like, you can't just, like, if your friend texts you on a Friday night and is like, do you wanna do something tonight? You have to think about it, like, do I want to put myself in a situation where there's like loads of food when I'm this hungry? Or do I even wanna socialize when I'm this tired? Like, it's extreme, and people can say like, it's taking it too far or whatever, but people who do this sort of thing, you have to respect that there's a love for it and there's a love for pushing the body to its limits. Just make sure that you understand what you're undertaking. This isn't meant to like put people off. It's the most rewarding thing in the world. Like, I love what I do, but it is a challenge, a huge challenge in fact. It's the hardest thing I've ever done and I continue to do it. So there must be a reason for that. Okay, part three is the prep. So I'm gonna come back to the coach subject now. I would recommend 100% getting a coach for your competition prep. I personally do not think that doing a prep without a coach is a good idea in any way. Especially if it's your first show, you need someone who knows more than you. You need someone who knows how to prep somebody. I would recommend getting someone who has competed before and who has prepped people like you before. If you feel like you're not willing to invest in a coach for your prep, then I'm gonna go ahead and say that you probably shouldn't prep. There's a lot that you have to invest in a prep, a lot of time, a lot of effort. You'll miss a lot of like social activities. You'll probably distance yourself from a few friends, maybe family. If you're not willing to invest the cost of a coach into it, then there's no way that you're gonna be able to invest all that stuff too. That's just what I think. Get a coach and get them to make you a plan, track your progress with you, keep you accountable and keep you going. Cause when the going gets tough, if there's nobody to tell you to just suck it up and get on with it, or nobody to tell you what to do when something goes wrong, then I don't even know. So in a prep, the main thing to consider is your prep length. So this is determined by how much body fat you have to lose and also how aggressive an approach you want to take. A typical competition prep is kind of 12 to 16 weeks. That's kind of average. I like to do a 16 week prep, and that's because it's short enough that you can kind of always see the end goal in sight, and that's really important for me to have like a kind of mental grasp on what I'm doing. 16 weeks for me has been long enough to get to the leanness that I require. Bear in mind that people who have done this a few times, they'll kind of know their body and know what their body will react well to. If you compare my first competition prep to my most recent competition prep, you'll see that I have learned a lot, or we have learned a lot, and now know what to do with my body when it does certain things, or like how carb tolerant I am and what foods I react well to and things like that. Your first prep, even if you have the best coach in the world, it's still a trial and error. That's just me giving you a kind of overview of what preps tend to look like. But again, the person that will be able to tell you this the best will be your coach, who's been able to see like your pictures, your measurements, your kind of training history and things like that as well. Other things that come into play in competition prep, I'm not gonna go into too much detail about these because I actually made another video about this a while ago, so I'm gonna link that in the description below. But the other main things to consider in competition prep are cardio. The more fat you have to lose, the more cardio you'll do, typically. Macros, again, depending on how much fat you have to lose and how kind of carb tolerant you are, what your diet was like before, all these things play a part in what kind of macro breakdown you'll use. Check-ins. Most people have online coaches, so you'll send them a check-in. So it'll be like photos of yourself and measurements of that week compared to like the previous week, so that you can see what changes you made in that week and whether or not you need to hit your diet or your cardio a little bit harder for the following week. Posing. This is something that a lot of people forget about, I think, is that when you're prepping for a show, you're also practicing posing all the time. You wanna nail that routine on stage. So I would recommend getting a posing coach or just get someone who's kind of good at that sort of thing. People who dance tend to be very good at posing. It's definitely not a dance, but just people with good coordination tend to know like shapes the body can make and where the body looks best. Going back to the first point, in different federations, there will be certain regulations, so make sure you keep that in mind. And lastly, dedication. This is the number one ingredient into a successful prep. You cannot waver from your diet plan for a number of reasons, not just because if you have like a Twix bar, it's going to make you fat. Like, that's not the point. When you're on competition prep, it's so finely tuned, like your macros are so measured that if you stray from them, then you really don't know if those macros are working for you or not. So you need to be 100% dedicated and you need to do exactly what your coach tells you. And if you do go off diet, you need to tell them. And if you do miss your cardio, you need to tell them, because if they think you're doing everything you're telling them and you're not progressing, then they will change what you're doing. It might not actually need changed if you're not sticking to it. Dedication is the number one thing. Okay, part four is on the day. So it's show day, you've prepped for like 12, 16 weeks, whatever, and it's finally here. I'm just gonna talk you through a kind of standard show day structure. Typically, show days tend to be long days. So you'll likely have like 4 or 5 meals in Tupperwares just ready. You may or may not eat them depending on where you are, like in the running order. Depending on what you're looking like or what your coach thinks, you may change your diet on this day. So some people eat nothing on show day at all, actually. Some people do that. Some people throw in new food sources, like certain foods can help like blood flow into the muscles, certain foods can kind of draw water from the skin, so there's loads of different things you can do. Sometimes people will cut water to dehydrate them further so that they look even leaner and drier on stage. Some people will put extra carbs in because it'll make you like more vascular and again appear leaner. So there's loads of different things you can do with food on show day, and this really depends on how your body reacts to these foods and whether your coach has like had time to test these things with you. So show structure, there tends to be two parts to your stage time. So there is an individual round and a comparison round. So in the individual round, you tend to do something called a T-walk or sometimes an I-walk. So a T-walk, you walk to the front of the stage, you hit some poses, you walk to the side of the stage, hit some poses, to the other side of the stage, hit some poses, and then back to join like the line or to walk off stage. An I-walk is pretty much the same thing, but you just walk to the front and hit some poses and then off. That's normally how the individual part works. That will probably last like 30 to 60 seconds. And secondly, there's the comparison round. Usually you'll line up with all the other girls that you're up against. They will say, everybody face the front, and you'll all hit your front pose. And then they'll say, turn to the right, face the other side, and then back around to the front again. And then if they're unsure of placings, they might make you like do some more turns. I will also mention that some categories in different shows are completely different from this, and some have a kind of almost dance-like routine or kind of skilled routine, like a skill of your choice, and this is completely different, and I'm not going to talk about this because I don't know a lot about it. In some shows, they also do a pre-judging round. I have never experienced this myself, and I actually think it's quite an American thing, and I'm in the UK, so I believe they will do like a pre-judging round in the morning without an audience. I think this is right. They'll pick their winner, they'll pick, like they'll rank you all in order, and then you go away, and like I think everyone like goes and eats food and like has a cheat meal, and then they come back in the evening and there's the evening show. And I think this is so like in the evening show the judges don't have to like be there, or I don't know if they're still there or if they don't have to like judge as much, but yeah, I don't know if they like finalize the rankings or if they just kind of get it into their head, but I'm gonna stop now because I don't know, there's a pre-judging show part sometimes. If you do know anything about this, then comment below because I really would like to clarify this. I'm gonna end that there. I hope that this was useful to some of you. I hope I haven't missed anything. I try my best to cover as much as possible there. Like I said, if you're interested in more about competition prep itself, I'll link the other video below. If you like this, give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe and leave your comments below if you have any questions about this at all. So yeah, I'm gonna stop rambling now, but I hope you all enjoyed this and I will see you all in the next one. Bye.